All right, let's get this show on the road. Hi.
Hello.
Hair's still a little duck. Hi, this is Brendan, and this will be the first Accidental Origin Midweekly Fun Stream. For those who don't know, Accidental Origin is a weekly web show on Sundays at 7 p.m. Eastern about writing. Kind of a thing I do. And I wanted to do some more midweek stuff. Just to get myself on Twitch a little bit more, and B, because a lot of my friends who I hang out with on here are European and can't necessarily make the regular show. So I'm going to try and do this more regularly. Currently, right now, this week, I'm working on my design for Game Chef 2016, which is a analog game competition running over 9 days. So we're about halfway through. Submission date for me living in Canada is June 13th at 6 a.m., which is Monday morning. So I will submit Sunday night on after the next Accidental Origin stream, which I'll probably be doing some InDesign stuff and doing a lot of the sort of setting up text and design stuff related to making games, analog games specifically. That's what we're doing right now. Go back to my main screen here. So this is a concept I've been working on. It's a map making game concept, designed primarily kind of like doing dungeon crawling sort of thing. Based on the main theme for this year's competition, which is technology. The technology I'm kind of running with is cartography. So we're going to talk a little bit about cartography in general. Cartography. So I have a bunch of notes here, stuff I've been working on over the week. So I'm just going to go through my doc and I'm going to keep adding stuff. I will compile and post a thing real quick here. Projects, Game Chef. There we go. So I made a few quick updates there. And I'm going to post this on my Discord. Oh, yeah. My Discord. Text general real quick here. The File dump it is. Upload that real quick. So if anyone wants to take a look, current version. /8/2016/12:00 p.m. There we go. That's there. If people want to check it out, just ask me for the Discord. I have a link in my Netbot thing. You can see that real quick. Come on, there we go. So yeah, alright. So we're gonna skip into some mechanics right now. I have some stuff that I wanted to work on. Okay. So, character creation. No rooms is pick. One pack from each of the three categories. And give your character a name. Skill, power, gear. Yeah. These skills. Guess what? One packet. Categories. And give your character name. Skill. Our gear. What's that? Okay. Yes. That makes sense. We're gonna make a new doc here. I need at least four skill packages and at least four of each of the packages. So we're just gonna go 1, 2, 3, 4. Hat, power, gear, examples. I need at least two examples. So what kind of skills do we think we're gonna have in this game? I think let's throw some stuff down here. Where did I write this? Here we go. Special abilities package, which is... Hey Johnny, how's it going? I'm doing a thing. Said I was gonna do a thing, so I'm doing a thing. Abilities pack. This is where we're going to have their hit / health points. So these packages. Oh. And I've changed my mind. I want it. Well, keeping in mind that the rules are not nearly finished. So it's it's not going to be a great, like, example as of yet of how the game is going to be played, and I'm still kind of working on it, so, yeah, no problem. It's all good. One special power. Good point. These packages contain one weapon skill, one exploration skill, yeah, it's due Monday morning my time, like 6 a.m. So I'm going to submit it Sunday night after, not necessarily like right after, but basically after my stream Sunday night. Because you weren't here for the intro, I'm going to be doing InDesign stuff on Sunday. Basically, I'm going to get it all, as much of the text done until... then, and then on that stream, I'm going to put it all into InDesign and make it look cool and do some cool things. I don't think there's going to be damage on enemies. Yeah, let's say not. Let's say no... We're going to do a real basic damage system here. I'm going to write it down. Somewhere in these sheets. Yeah, which would be cool is you can give me tips, because I have used InDesign to do newspaper stuff, but I've never really done a ton of it. But it is the thing I need to use, because I am going to be laying out basically a PDF ebook, so... So, damage... alright, I need a combat section. Combat. Damn it. Yeah, so I do know a little bit of, I do know more than most people, like people who have never used it, because again, yeah, we used it when I worked on the newspaper, so it was significantly better, like significantly harder stuff. Jason Pitt, one of the guys I know who does game design, swears that RPG layouts are the hardest thing ever. I find that hard to believe over newspaper design, because newspaper design is so friggin' hardcore. Oh my god. But, you know, maybe. We'll see. Hitting with a weapon does one damage. So because of that, HP count will be pretty low. Traps do damage to. Also, does that. HP counts will... Oh, there's a thing I could do. And I wanted to play around with it. How does the mic sound better? Because I mess around with the settings on the noise gate, so it shouldn't be nearly as like white noisy. But I don't know. I did test it. I think it's okay. That's really cool. Set this. Third one. Yeah, I'm gonna make it a duplicate of this. Main screen. Second camera. This. We're doing live fun things. Okay, check this out. You're gonna love this. Okay, so I just made a new scene here. Check this out. I got like a little gorilla tripod thing. As you probably can't see this now. Little gorilla tripod thing. So my second webcam's on that. We don't need that later. Or I forget. So you can see that I don't actually like smash my keys. That's just... There, you can only see three of the five bookshelves from there. Plus I have a trunk. Plus the trunk. Right. Back to skills. Skill factor. One weapon skill, one exploration skill. So let's just make this basic. Swordsman. Now I buy most of them used. A lot of them I got from my dad. Because he's had, like, collected a ton of books over the years. So I have a lot of old science fiction books and pulp books, and probably the biggest investment would be in, like, the manga and stuff, more than anything else. But. Sword. Skill. Yeah, my dad was a huge reader. Oh yeah, it is. You know things, Ronnie. It's not all about me. You need this on packages, and you can roll against your preparedness. I realize now that I have not set the mechanic for doing rolls, especially action rolls and stuff like that. Yeah. My work lunch for today is pulled pork and pasta. I eat a ton of pasta. Okay, what kind of stuff is going to be in here? Nah, I don't cook very much. Too lazy. Well, that's not true. I'm too busy. I do what I can. I will also have to write more detailed descriptions. Of what this kind of stuff means. Like, when I say one set of armor, what does that mean? For me, I'm kind of going more of the Games Workshop, oh god, what's that game called? The game I've played a million times. Have it on Steam. Like, a bunch of other stuff. Good job, Dronny. I'm proud of you. Ooh, a new Space Run game. Cool. Talisman. That's what I'm trying to think of. The Talisman around. Armor allows you to roll a die when you're about to receive damage. On a 5 plus or 5 or 6, you can negate a point of damage. It's more allergies, a little bit. Just a little stuffed, you know? Listen around. Okay. was thinking about it. Do I want... I'm not sure if I want to use the... the typical fantasy races sort of thing. Wait, oh yeah, Johnny? Are you an expert on traditional games now? I thought you hated playing board games because your family was too competitive. I mean, you're not entirely wrong, because this, at least to me, is designed like a role-playing game. And the role-playing games that you play on the computer, which I think are what you're thinking of, are based heavily in the traditional games that that this is more designed like. At least in my opinion. This could work as a video game, because video games made of board games can be very cool. But yeah. The problem with making it a video game is there's a lot of elements to the multiplayer aspect which do not work in the same way in a video game. It's like if I play Settlers of Catan, like the video game version, I always win. I win on hard, I win by excessive margins. I played a game 2 days ago where I legit, I won with 20 points and the person, next closest person to me had 9. But yet when I play with my friends, I get wrecked all the time. I win a few, but I get wrecked. I think there's more aspects to this than you'd have to program really, really good AI, and I don't think it would work as well. But you never know. I mean, I'm not opposed to the idea. I think it works better as an analog, to be honest. And part of that is also just the physical drawing of the map and how much that relies on your own skills. Your own like cartography skills. So yeah. I want there to be a power that like allows you to see into the next room or something similar to that, but that doesn't really work because the next room hasn't been generated yet. Then you'd have to pre-generate a room, but if you pre-generate a room, everyone would know about it, and thus the power would kind of be rendered moot. So it doesn't really work. Maybe something like a... maybe like a detect trap sort of skill? Power ability thing. through it. Where am I? Get running power. No. It's kind of more of a bragging rights thing. I'm only doing it because it's short and because I did that, like, game design thing, at the convention. So it just was more of a personal challenge to me to do something, get it done, do a good job. A new character. Start from. Also, copy the comment. No, the game is actively influenced by the players themselves. Kind of thing. I mean, it probably makes a lot more sense in my head than anything else, but... I kind of am. The way it is. Awesome. Dice. Roll 8 dice. Yeah. Try to describe. Yeah. Whatever, Johnny. Because the rules aren't all there yet. Once they're all there, it'll make sense. Just. Other modern places. Grocery store. Family home. Movie theater. This might not make any sense. Police station. What do you mean by engine? Oh, yeah, makes more. thinking through this example of play, and I originally wanted there to be secret information. That's cool. But then it just strikes me as odd because it's like I'm not sure how I want the things to handle it. Well, I mean, one solution to the problem of having is that I could just make it more of a role-playing game than I originally thought it was. Where instead of it being solely based on the map and map movements, it's actually more about narrative role-playing. So that's an option. Where the players are almost their own GM. First style thing. But I mean, maybe just the problem is the dice pool. As much as I like the idea of designing rooms, maybe that's the problem. Maybe it should be more random. If it's more random, then you can have secret information. Or better secret information. But then what information is secret? I know I have the power, but it's more about like what makes for fun and interesting gameplay. What works. Don't know. It's one of those things that I need to talk out. I gotta talk through possibilities. Okay, so the issue I'm facing right now is that, first and foremost, I have a problem with how rooms are set up, because in the current iteration, basically, with four choices, you're forced to choose a room type, a number of doors, a trap, and an enemy. And see, the problem I have with that is that means that you're forced to have a trap and an enemy. And the best way for those to work is through secret ballot, basically. Like, through secret construction. And I don't know. I mean, one of the ways that I could approach it is I could approach it as I could approach it as you make the map first. Then you put your characters in it and make them go through it. Right? Well, that kind of wrecks the narrative sort of style of the game. But it could work. Because then players can reveal secret information about the map as people move into different rooms. The other way you could do it is you could do it where, what was the second way? I had a second way. Oh, the second way you could do it is you could remove the idea of characters altogether. And just have you as the player interact with just the map. You have a character marker indicating where you are. Everything you do is based on just dice rolls or something. But I don't see how that would be... I guess that wouldn't be theoretically all that different from having characters. So I guess that wouldn't really matter. I'm not entirely sure. I mean, I am basically just talking to myself at the moment. So, I mean, bingo, there it is. So, like, I went back and I did another, another design overview sheet. So I'm gonna I open that now just to see, you know, maybe using that I can kind of figure out where my focuses are and what I'm trying to do with it. I've spoken to several people, and we all think the concept is solid. It's just a matter of what mechanics will make the concept work. I don't have a ton of time, so I've been kind of running with just the ones that I instantly come up with. And that's fine, but I just feel like I'm missing something, like an integral piece that will bring it all sort of together. Because, like, I haven't even really settled on how the characters move through the map. And, I think part of my problem is that I'm thinking of it a little bit too much like an old school Dungeons & Dragons sort of style game. And that might be a problem. Where it's kind of forcing my thinking into a certain vein, and that's not necessarily the right sort of mindset. Like, that's not the right thing for what I'm trying to do. Just looking right now at that game that Chess Diver recommended the other time there. Looking at stuff. Maybe my issue is right now that you only map one room at a time. And I'm wondering if maybe that's my issue. Because I'm worried about the active player having too much information, or about players having to put certain pieces into that specific thing. And I'm wondering if maybe the better way is to have all the information secret. Yeah, I think that's up to the players, because one of the things I do talk about in the book is a little bit about cartography. And I think those decisions are cartography decisions. So it's up to you whether or not you want to use multiple colors or whether you want to do, but that'll only be for your personal map. It's probably going to be just black or whatever the group decides on for the main map. Maybe what should happen is maybe a mix of what I was saying, where instead of designing the entire map first, what happens is there's a map making turn, and then there's a character turn, where, yeah, see, that sounds really good to me. That makes so much more sense. There are two phases in each turn of the game. Mapping phase. This is legitimately. Remember when we were talking about personality types, like last week or whatever? This is what my personality type does. And I don't believe 100% in personality types is like, this is the way you have to act. But it's definitely something I do, that specific part of it, where I can literally just, if I just keep working through a problem and talking to people about it, even, like, I know I'm kind of talking to myself right now, but at the same time, I'm talking to the general Twitch audience. So I legitimately, like, just keep talking, and it'll just process, and it'll get there. So I'm gonna have to change my terminology. I'm gonna leave it like this for now, just because it's the only way that it, like, I'm gonna get it down. But I'm gonna have to change my terminology because it's not gonna be very descriptive like this. Because the way I'm thinking about it is that there's two main phases, and each player gets two turns in those each player gets a turn in each phase. So that's where it gets weird. But yeah. So yeah, there'll be a mapping phase, and then there'll be a character phase. It will say each section. Part, day, I don't know, I'll figure out a way to break it up so it makes sense. So it'll be mapping phase and character phase. So we'll say a new mapping phase. Rolling mapping. And then we're going to go new character phase. Searching characters and searching. Character actions and searching. So yeah, there we go. So the way that this is going to work is... so the way that this is going to work is that each player gets a mapping turn, and then after that, each player gets a character turn. So basically what I'm doing is, instead of designing one room and then a character gets to act, you're designing one room per player, and then the character, and then all the characters get to act. So we're basically saying, like, instead of drawing one room per turn and then having that player go with their character, we're going to draw four rooms and then have that character go. And then have all four characters go. So the reason that this makes more sense is because what it does is it puts a lot more information on the table. The dice pool makes more sense, because if we do it the right way, I might have to expand the dice pool, but basically the way it'll work is the dice pool, it'll be a common dice pool for the entire turn, which will make a lot more sense. And because then your options get a lot more limited, and there are certain other things that happen. It means that only you as the player know what option you've selected, as long as you tick one, like, I'm still trying to figure out, how to handle, things like, things like crossover. Like, so if you say, well, each player needs to pick a specific, has to pick a something that further describes this room, and two players pick the same thing without knowing, how do you resolve that? Is there a way to resolve that? Do you force the players to pick one of a certain thing? But then if you force players to pick one of a certain thing, then you kind of get into my problem where you have to pick a trap, or you have to pick an enemy, or you have to pick certain things. So I'm wondering, I'm still kind of trying to figure out how to get around that. That being said, this makes a lot more sense to me, because it's basically like saying, well, here's the dice pool, and this is what these are your options, and then I realize that I didn't explain that at all, but you know, whatever. It's that when you go around the room, you're gonna know, when you do the mapping phase, you're gonna know four things about four different rooms that nobody else at the table knows, other than the existence of the room. Which I think will be more interesting. Because part of the problem I was having before was, I was saying, well, the character moves into the room. And it's like, well, but it doesn't really make sense like that. Like, it doesn't... It's like, because then you're forced to interact with the things inside that room that people just set up. It doesn't really make sense. I think the map-making aspect needs to be kind of separate from the character aspect. Which is why I've done it this way. So yeah, I think that makes so much more sense. I mean, it does mean I have to change the dice pool. It means that we're gonna have to go up to 4 six-sided dice per player. I think. No, it would be Yeah, no, 4 six-sided dice per player would be a 1-4 player game. Perfect. Done. It is like detective work. That's not entirely wrong. Or wrong at all. It's just, that's kind of what it's like. Makes so much more sense. It makes so much more sense to me. Still not all of the way there yet. Still experimenting with mechanics. But this makes a lot more sense to me. I think the thing that I need to figure out next, like the thing I majorly need to figure out next, is I need to figure out how how I can expand the tables or have a way of making it so that you're not forced into picking enemies or traps, or maybe that there's more categories of enemies or traps to pick from that'll change kind of how they interact with each other. Spice and Dice sounds like a cool caravan-y crossing the desert dice game, which you should totally make. Not like I'm challenging you or anything. Well, there's tons of questions, but questions that come out of answers are better questions. If that makes any sense. It's because the answers, the questions that come out of answers tend to be smaller questions that are more easily answered. So, you know, it is what it is. I'm gonna go check something really quick. I just gotta see what time I need to leave. So give me a quick sec, and I'll be right back. I thought I clicked the button to unmute. I'm back. I'm staying for a bit. Like another half hour. But yeah, with the change to the phasing, this stuff makes more sense. Yeah, it just makes more. I might not need this high. I'm gonna star this. I don't know if this is 100% necessary. It's a good call, and Sam made a good point about it, but I just don't know if you... I don't know if you have enough character actions where you would actually need it. There is... Oh, Jay's game's already started? Holy crap. How old is my target group? My target group is probably mid-20s to mid-30s. People who have played older school Dungeons & Dragons games. Want something in that vein that's a little bit more casual, that sort. So, where is that? To write that down somewhere. Well, yeah. What did you think I meant by a role-playing game? I specifically stated that I thought that this was kind of going to be more like Lords of Waterdeep and like the D&D board game style board games and like things like Zork and the old school text-based adventure games. So yeah. Yeah. Let's... I can explain it real quick. Just give me a sec to finish it. Hey, Sam Peterson Art, how goes it? Johnny, Dungeons and Dragons in a nutshell. So the idea is that you make a character who has certain stats and skills. So things that it's good at and how it handles certain generalities. So basically the base six, and they're like commonly used in most role-playing games nowadays. So it's like strength, dexterity, wisdom, charisma, intelligence, and fortitude are kind of like the six main stats. And then you got a bunch of skills that you have ranks in, and then special feats that are part of how you've leveled up your character and what class you are. And then you basically go through an adventure set up by a dungeon master or a game master, and roll against those skills to accomplish things. Is kind of the gist. And it all takes place in your head, like a big fantasy imagination. There's that. Dungeons and Dragons in a nutshell. What are we thinking here? What do we think? Those are all fine. I think these will definitely work. It's fairly easy once you've had someone like sit down and explain it, go through it with you. It's not as hard as it sounds. It makes a lot of sense, and it deals a lot with natural oral storytelling sort of style stuff. And there are some good games out right now which are more like light versions of that, like Dungeon World, for example, that have a much more narrative base and are less stat heavy or skill heavy or rule heavy. I basically do have an elevator pitch. It's in the introduction here. It's this guy. It's my elevator pitch. It's like an RPG light do-it-yourself board game. Makes perfect sense. I want powers to be, especially, like, I want them to be good, like, good enough that you wouldn't, like, they'd be too powerful to use every turn, but I don't know how you would track that, how you would track things like cooldown right now. You could use, like, a counter, but then how many turns do you have on cooldown? So for the moment, I'm just gonna say, it's mostly just a joke, Johnny, because it might not actually be harder. This is a joke. Don't worry too much about it. Your turn. Traps in the room. months per. Roll a die. On a 5 or 6. Six. The other players must reveal if there's any reveal a single trap in the room, if any. So, Sam Peterson, what's your morning routine like? Describe it to me. Tell me a story. That's what we do here. We do storytelling. You. Sort of thinking through things as we go. I got nothing else right now for those, but okay. Exploration skill. I think there should be a sword. Soldier. This should be a rogue. Not sure what this should be. Thinking through. You are gonna get disarm traps. It's your exploration skill. I'm thinking of the traditional sort of style your traditional D&D classes here. Aaron Bard Druid.
Have a magic user with a staff. That'd be cool. It would make more sense. Let's do that. Dude. Wizard. Soldier. Cool. Wait, some more stuff. Magic of some sort. You can some sort of track enemy. Enemy detection thing. I have to think about that. And maybe this guy has the preparedness skill. Is that a thing? Huh, yeah. So there we go. We're starting to see some things come out. I'm trying to think of gears. I think that's okay for now. I'll have to think about that stuff more. On one side. Cool. Okay. Starting to make some progress here. Pretty happy. Traps and decided that contents was really the same as room type for the moment. What are you challenged about, Johnny? I don't understand why you're so confused. Don't get it. Not. Now, more questions. All the questions. That's what I'm good at. Why does room type matter other than to set the scene? Obviously, it's because we should have some sort of room type. Like, some of the room types. Should have obstacles that you would need to traverse. right? Like, that's why it would be important. So maybe the ones that I've thought up here with just, like, the flavor text are wrong. Maybe they should just be more, And, I mean, you could theoretically do it more of, like, different tables, right? Because if you're keeping your selection secret, you could do different tables. So, like, you could have one table of like, flavor. And then a second table that's like terrain stuff, and then a third table that would be like, I don't know, like a third table would be maybe stuff with certain rules. the way you know anything in this world, because someone tells you, or you tell yourself. That's kind of the thing about role-playing games in general, right, Johnny? Is that they are designed role-playing games are designed to have like possibilities. They're not designed in the same way that a video game is designed. There's not nearly as many constraints to how it progresses. That being said, as a sort of pseudo board game, this one, you're confined to rooms. And B, all of the information about the rooms is going to be on other people's maps. So I guess the thing you're confused about is there's five. In a four-player game, there would be five maps. There's one map for each player, plus a fifth global map in the center. The fifth global map basically just shows any information that's been revealed to all players. So, for example, when you get to the room design phase, or the mapping phase, each player draws a room on the map. So then there's four rooms on the map, right? Then, so there's four rooms on the map, and all you know is that there's four rooms. But because of the way that this system works is every player has chosen something from one of the categories, that means that there are four details about that room that each of the four players knows one detail about each of the four rooms. So that when someone interacts with a room, say things like traps, for example, if I set a trap in a room, and someone enters that room, I would reveal that there's a trap in that room when they hit the circumstances that would set it off. Like, for certain traps, that'll be entering the room. For other traps, not necessarily. Perhaps this only happens when you search a room. If you don't search a room, then maybe you don't set off a trap. I'm still working on the mechanics of that. But that's the idea, is that when you enter a room, the person who said what room type it is would state what room type it is. So in a lot of ways, you're kind of using the non-active players, like the players whose turn it isn't, you're using them as temporary game masters, where they're revealing things about the room as it goes along. Right? So, say you enter a room and a guy reveals that it's a abandoned hospital. Right? Or part of an abandoned hospital. Then you find out that, oh, there's an orc in that room. So then, now you're presented with options. As a character, you have to do things. Which is why I like the sort of the mapping phase and the character phase being separate. Because I feel like with the more information, it actually expands the possible options. And it also makes it so that it makes the information harder to keep track of. Which in this case is kind of a good thing. Because it means that it's not one individual's responsibility for keeping track of the information. So that makes it easier in general. But also that it's harder for one person to track the available information and gain an advantage because of that. So, did I explain it better that time? Do you get it now? Or better? Do you understand it better? I won't say you necessarily get it entirely, but... And I mean, one of the ways that you can handle the tables, which is kind of the way Fiasco does, and I have sort of pseudo based this game on Fiasco's dice pool, but you can do it where you have to use a die to pick a table, sort of thing, which might make perfect sense. So that actually limits your options a little bit more, where it's saying, oh yeah, well, you have to pick a non-lethal trap, but you can pick which of the non-lethal traps are there. I haven't decided yet whether or not rooms change their features or whether or not they're fixed. I feel like fixed is the better option because it'll make things easier for everybody, but it's also the less challenging option. But maybe, I mean, maybe that can be sort of maybe that's something I can include in my variants or something. Not that I have many at the moment, but sort of the way I'm thinking about it. I could put a variant where things aren't permanent. Because part of the way I was thinking about it was that it'd be cool as if, well, say you had part of a dice pool, say, well, oh, I want to add a trap to a different room, or something like that. And that may kind of make sense to me, but I don't know what... Oh, you know what? Hey, that's a good idea. I will write that down. That is interesting. But you could do it where, and the way I'm kind of approaching this game at the moment, maybe it's just the way I approach game design in general, but I approach, a game like this where you could publish supplements that would add rules or change rules or add variants. very easily. Where you could put some of these like sort of special type runes in one of those supplements. But the way that might work was I was wondering what else a character could do on their turn. So, you know, have such things like search a room and use a skill and stuff like that. But it is possible that maybe you could change something about the room as part of your character action, or as one of your potential character actions. And you know what the interesting thing is? Yeah, well, I figured you deserved it because you show up to everything ever. So, one of the interesting things is because I've changed the mapping phase and the movement phase, things like character actions actually become a little bit more important. Because you're not forced to move from room to room. Right? Like in the previous edition, like in the previous way I had set it up, you kind of had to move or new rooms were never made, and that didn't really make sense. So now things like movement actually matter. So you can stay in a room and do a second action in a room or before moving into a new room or something like that. It gives you a lot more tactical options as a character. At least I think. Or the way I'm approaching it now, it seems to me that it would do that. So, there's certainly that. Dice are at the moment are for making the map, like designing the rooms, and are also used to resolve skill checks and combat. I haven't really detailed a lot of that, and maybe that's something I should do soonish. How does combat work? I'm thinking sort of a 2d6 style system with opposed rolls, but I'm not sure. That does make sense to me, though, the 2d6 plus opposed rolls. In terms of the influences of games on this, this is kind of like a fiasco version of Dungeons & Dragons using a board game-like style like Talisman. So using the Talisman style of like 2d6 sort of thing would make perfect sense. Like 2d6 opposed roll. So like I roll dice and then the player to my left rolls for my enemy. And if I roll higher than them, then I win. Sort of thing. Alright, I win and do damage. And if they die, then if they die, then combat's over. If they don't, then perhaps you're locked in combat for another turn. I'm not going to forget. I got 15 more minutes. Where is that part of this? Do I not have a thing for combat? I do have a thing for combat. Where'd it go? Where's chapter 5? Where, what? Chapter 3. Why is half of the time? Oh, I just made that. That's why. I was like, what? How do skill checks combat work. Taking 2d6 opposed. Not what other stuff have I not fleshed out enough? Or haven't thought about enough? Not sure.
Not sure.
There is a way to win the game. You have to find pieces of technology and bring the map to the king by escaping the place. I'm thinking that I'm wrong about the setup. I think there should be draw one entrance to the ruins per side. Four entrances. I have to figure out how searching the room works and how finding technology works. Like, maybe, I know I moved it here, but maybe there's a searching table, and on that searching table, there's options for what can be found in the room. Oh, better yet. Perhaps, instead of doing it like what can be found, you can do it as a table of number of things that can be found, and the number of things gets randomly rolled when you search the room. So then what you can say is if there's like, if you can find three things in this room, then
that room can be searched 3 times. And if technology doesn't show up in any of those, like, it can be searched 3 times. And that's it. So there's a 3 or, like, however many potential chances for you to find technology in a room. But it's not a guarantee that you're going to find technology in a room. Does that make sense? I think that makes perfect sense. I would actually gonna write that down. Make a table for that. And it's basically gonna be the same table as the number of doors. I'll just copy and paste that across. You might tweet that later, but I think that's okay for now. For J. You search the room. Every room gets assigned a finding thing value. I don't know. I'll come up with a better name for that too. I don't think that's a great name. It's kind of confusing. That means that this room can be searched a number of times equal to that value. See, Johnny. That's why, like, my friends are all like, oh, this sounds like a great concept. It just, not sure how the mechanics will all play out yet. And that's kind of going to be the hard part, is figuring out if the mechanics are balanced at all, or if they work at all. But that being said, in this competition, as much as it's trying to make it's not trying to make a finished product, it's trying to make a really good first draft of a product. So that's okay. If the values aren't great, they aren't great. But it's the concept and how they work and whether or not you've thought things out properly and certain things that really make a difference. So, yeah. Oh, yeah, and the other reason, you asked me before, one of the other reasons why I'm doing this is because there's guaranteed feedback. And that's kind of an important thing when it comes to a competition, because it means that people who... this one's mostly peer feedback, but at the same time, like, you're guaranteed to get at least 4 things of feedback. So, hopefully that'll be helpful for me kind of, like, moving forward from a game design perspective. So, yeah. I think that makes more sense. I think that makes so much more sense for how this game plays out. It's only for analog games. It's not traditional necessarily, but it's supposed to be meant to be played at like a table with friends sort of thing. That being said, because of the theme of this year being technology, there has been kind of a sort of question of what makes up an analog game. How can you use technology as integrated with an analog game? I'm not exploring that super heavily at the moment. mostly because I don't want to. But there were some cool designs floating around in the Google Plus circle for that. Because they use Google Plus because they're awesome RPG hipsters. Where they there's like a guy doing a game with like QR codes and like some other stuff similar to that. It's explicitly not supposed to be a video game. Though they were talking, again, because of the technology sort of theme, they were talking about, you know, things like ways to blend those two. And what makes one different from the other. So yeah. So yeah, there's certainly that. Other than that, I gotta go. So this is pretty much it. So thanks to all you all who tuned in. Thanks for coming, Johnny. I see you still there, Wordwind, though you might have actually left a while back. Thanks for coming and chilling with me. Lurking, as it were. And tell Sam Peterson thanks for coming, Johnny. Even if he peaced out when I asked him to tell me a story. So yeah. I was kind of hoping Derek would be done earlier than he is, so that he could come hang with me. But I guess he's putting in a long one today, so oh well. But yes, I will see y'all later. Bye-bye. Thanks, Johnny. Bye.